If you are in sales or marketing, then you need to understand what the buyer's journey is. And if you haven't heard this phrase, it is also commonly referred to as the sales funnel. Stick around to the end of this video as I will break down how to use a sales funnel approach and provide you with a sample strategy that you can begin to leverage starting today. Let's jump right into it. The buyer's journey is a framework that marketers and salespeople use to understand the different stages that a potential customer transitions through when they're making a purchase decision. Now, the sales funnel is the most popular visual depiction that you will find, thus why most people might be familiar with the term sales funnel and not with the term buyer's journey. So there are three main stages to the funnel. There's awareness, consideration, and conversion. There are a lot more elaborate and complex ways to depict the buyer's journey with many more stages, and depending on your business and how complex the purchase is, it might make sense to develop your sales funnel a little bit further. But for the sake of simplicity and time, let's just focus on the three main stages for now. And once you have a better understanding, we can jump into some more comprehensive versions. Sound good? Cool. Now, stage number one is awareness. It's when a customer becomes aware that they have a need. So for example, if you just dropped your cell phone and the screen cracked, the moment you realized that it was cracked and busted and you picked it up and you became aware of your need to fix your phone, that is when you became aware. This doesn't necessarily mean that you're aware of the brand or service that will solve your problem. It just means that you're aware and you know you have a problem and need a solution. So at this point, it's when you typically begin to consider your options, and we transition into the second stage. Stage two is consideration. This is when you are actively researching your options to solve your problem. Now, there are a few different ways someone could solve a cracked screen phone problem. Number one, you can accept it and leave it as is, move on with your life. Number two, if you have insurance through your cell phone carrier, you can pay a flat fee and receive a new or refurbished phone in the mail. Now, if you don't have insurance, you might consider one of two things, either buying a new or used phone on eBay or Amazon, or you might decide that it's better to pay $75 to $100 and just get the screen repaired. For example, let's say if you decided to get your screen repaired because you didn't have insurance and you just spent like, I don't know, $1 million, I'm just kidding, $800 to buy a brand new iPhone, and you couldn't afford a new or used phone at a time. So you decide, I'm gonna get the screen repaired. Now you start to do some research and you pop open Google and search iPhone screen repair near me or some variation of that. The search results come up and you see the ads on Google first, and then as you scroll below, you start to see some of the top search results. An important thing to note here is that if you have previously been exposed to ads for screen repair businesses, this is where you would potentially recall the brand. And because you have seen it before, you would be more likely to click on it as you're gonna have a higher level of trust in that brand. Once you're on the brand website, you start to enter the evaluation phase of the sales funnel or the buyer's journey, which is often represented within the consideration stage. In this phase, you are looking at the website and you're scanning key information that is part of your buying criteria, such as price, maybe location, services or specialization, maybe hours of operation, reviews. The criteria is gonna depend and it's gonna be different depending on the product or service category. For example, if you're looking for a coffee shop, your distance criteria might be one of the biggest factors for your decision. And if you were in a big city, you probably wouldn't be willing to go more than a few blocks for some good Java. Now, considering if you were looking to purchase a car, different situation. It's a different type of need. You might be willing to travel 5 times, maybe even 10 times further than the coffee shop if you found the car you wanted or the right deal. The better you can understand what your customer's buying criteria is, the better you're gonna be able to market to them. So lastly, we get into stage three, which is conversion. A conversion might be different for you depending on your business. It might be an actual purchase, a lead on your website. It could vary. Each business will determine what a conversion is differently. Now, regardless, your prospect has made it to the stage, then that means a few things. The customer became aware of a need, they decided they needed to find a solution, they landed on your website, you clearly communicated why you were the solution to their need, and number five, you made it easy for them to purchase. At this point, a common question you might have is, what if I communicated my value proposition or unique selling proposition on my website very clearly and I'm not getting sales or a good conversion? Well, there could be a number of reasons why a prospect is not buying from you, all the way from your price to your website experience to any other criteria that is part of their product slash service category criteria. That is why it is important for you to survey your customers regularly and perform market research to better understand them. A simple way of doing this is, if you have an email list, you can create a 3 to 5 question survey using SurveyMonkey and blast it out to your most engaged emails. If you want to create a more in-depth survey to get more information from your customers, you can provide an incentive such as a discount on a product or service or a gift of some sort. The better you understand the needs of your customer, the more effective your marketing communications will become, and that will have a major impact in your business results. So right now I want to shift gears a bit and talk about how you can use the sales funnel when creating strategy at a channel level. There are many different digital channels that you can use to drive your customer through the sales funnel, from social media to Google search to affiliate marketing to blogging and many more. For now, I just want to focus on 3 key channels that can work for almost any B2C or B2B business models. And the 3 channels are Facebook ads, Google search ads, and email. So why did I pick these 3? Well, according to Statista, in 2018, 61% of all global online advertising dollars will be absorbed by Facebook and Google because of their sheer size and scale and targeting effectiveness. And email, because it is an extremely effective channel to nurture potential customers, with 59% of B2B marketers saying it's their most effective channel. Let's jump into it. Awareness. Okay, so something that we can do here with Facebook is create video ads, which is phenomenal because people are not only able to view your product or service, but you can also add a call to action button to drive somebody to your website. You can have that call to action be learn more or sign up or download or buy now. Depending on your product and service, obviously it's going to change. Now, here's a tip. Depending on where you're at with your business, you might want to optimize your video ads for views versus a conversion. Now, I'll tell you the difference in 2 different situations. If you have a brand new website and you just put the Facebook pixel on your website, and you don't have enough data on the website, for example, if you have under 500 pixel fires, you probably don't want to optimize for conversions because Facebook won't really understand what a conversion will look like. So in that case, where you're just trying to get awareness for your brand and it is new to the market, you want to start with video ads that are optimized for video views, and you're going to use interest and behavior targeting, unless you have an existing sales list. But if you don't have a seed list of previous customers, interest and behavior targeting can be very, very effective to drive customers to your website. Now, another tactic you can use here is Google non-brand search ads. Now, if you're not familiar with non-brand, it's basically just ads that are not directly, it's basically for people that aren't directly searching your brand. So for example, if someone's just typing in phone repair or screen repair or fix my iPhone, those are some of the key terms that you can potentially buy against as people are actively searching potentially for somebody to help them repair their phone. Now, shifting over to the consideration stage, there's a few cool things we could do here. Now, remember our Facebook video ads that we were talking about over here? In this stage, you can actually retarget people who viewed your video depending on how far along they got in the video. So for example, if you had a 1-minute video, and let's say you wanted to retarget people that watched at least half of it, because if they watched 30 seconds of your video, there's some kind of level of intent they have with your product or service, and they're most likely to go to your website and buy it. So something you could do here is you can create a video retargeting audience of people who watched your video for up to 50% of the video and haven't visited your website. So they're still in this part somewhere. They're not here, they haven't bought anything yet, but we could potentially just get in front of them a few more times and push them down the funnel. According to Kantar and Millward Brown, the optimal amount of times, the minimum amount of times that somebody has to see your video for a message association, meaning what you're showing them connects to your marketing message is 5 to 7 times, with the optimal amount of times that they have to see your video is 9 times. Now just think about all the commercials you've seen on TV and how many times you had to see that commercial before you actually took an action against that brand. Now another thing you could do here is build some lookalike audiences and target against lookalike audiences. Now if you're not familiar with what a lookalike audience on Facebook is, it's pretty much you're gonna upload your customer seed list or your email list. Now if you didn't have one before, but maybe because you ran some great Facebook campaigns, you drove some purchases already, and let's just say now you have at least, I don't know, 200 sales or 200 emails. You can input that into Facebook and build a 1% lookalike audience, which means it's gonna be based on 1% of the country's population that is on Facebook. And those are the users that match the criteria of the people who previously purchased from you. In my experience, across every single campaign I've built, lookalike targeting has always significantly outperformed interest and behavior targeting. Now, if you already had a seed list, you could have used that before, but if not, this is a great time to use that, as these people are most likely to convert and turn into sales or dollars for you. Now, let's shift down to the consideration phase. So there's a few different things you can do here. The number one thing I would start is retarget your audiences. You should be retargeting anybody that's anybody that's been to your website and hasn't purchased anything yet. Assuming you have the Facebook pixel on your website, which you should have, anybody that's been to that website already has some kind of affinity and familiarity with the brand. So clearly you created some intent, or they already had some intent for their problem or their situation or their need. So that's like low-hanging fruit. Now, some tactical advice here: you want to target your audiences by different time frames. So for example, people that have been to your website within the last 14 days are way more likely to turn into a customer versus somebody that went to your website 6 months ago. So something you could do is build your audiences by recency. Maybe you can have a 14-day audience, separate maybe a 30 to 60-day audience, and maybe potentially an audience that's over 90 days. And one of the things you could do here is you can talk to them differently. You can say different things. Maybe somebody that hasn't been on your website in 6 months is gonna need a huge incentive, maybe a great discount to get them back interested in the brand, versus someone that's been on your website in the last 14 days maybe doesn't necessarily need a heavy promotion or a big deal to get them back to your website and turn them into a customer. So maybe these users just need a little bit more information to be a little bit more certain that they were buying from the right person, which they are. Now, another thing you wanna do here at your conversion level is run Google brand ads. Anybody that is searching for your brand on Google has a very high intent within the funnel to purchase. Now, you always wanna run your campaigns at 100% if you have the budget, so that you can capture anybody searching for your brand. And lastly, email. People that have been to your website and weren't necessarily ready to buy, that gave you their email, those were soft leads, and through an email nurture journey, you can build some more credibility with the users. You can provide them additional value through content potentially, and eventually bring them back to the website where they will hopefully convert. Maybe you need to give them a deal or some kind of offer within this journey. But if someone's been to your website, they've already expressed some level of interest, having a lead nurture campaign is a great way for you to produce results from some of those leads. And there you have it. That is the sales funnel and how we use it in marketing and in sales, obviously, also known as the buyer's journey. Now, I told you I was gonna give you a little bit of extra information about some of these different stages of the journey. Let's say, for example, someone is not aware of their need. Let's just say, for example, you're marketing a dream vacation. Someone might not be searching for a dream vacation. They might be unaware of their need. Using Facebook ads is actually a great avenue to create intent for someone that's not looking for something, because there's so much information that users volunteer into Facebook, and Facebook understands who are the people that like to take vacations, who are the people who'd like to spend a lot of money online. They have all this data integrated into their platform. Plus, people are always just volunteering this information when they're tagging themselves in trips and communicating with other brands. So that is a stage that's not represented in your typical funnel. We typically see awareness, consideration, and conversion, but a lot of marketers don't talk to you about unaware people or talk to you about what happens after you convert these users? That's a great question. Well, what do? You want to retain them. Not only retain them, but turn them into brand advocates. In another video, I'll get deeper into the sales funnel, but for now, hopefully this gave you a basic and simple breakdown of how the sales funnel works and how we use it as a framework to make decisions on strategies and on tactics. Now that you have a better understanding on how you can use a sales funnel framework, you should begin to do some research on your customers and map out their journey. Now the results that you're bound to get are so gonna be worth it. Hey guys, if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe if you found the information useful. And if you wanna see more videos like this. Until the next time, peace.